Can you hear me in the back?
Yes, I hear you.
We're okay? All right. Good evening. Welcome and happy holidays to everyone. I'm Mike Ehrman and I'm president of this group, and we have in our audience our leadership, a lot of it. Helen Wilson is hanging coats, but she otherwise is one of our vice presidents. Betty Connolly is our other vice president. We don't, our treasurer is in China, but Audrey.
With the money?
Investing, sir. Audrey Glickman in the back, at as they say, at the camera. Jim Hammond is here. Where's Jim? A board member. And Ralph Lund is here, a board member. We are a nonprofit organization run by a board. We're a membership organization, and we're right in the middle of this year's membership drive. I explained to folks who come to the meetings that we've been a membership organization for a long time, but for the first few years, we had written this book called The Squirrel Hill, the Arcadia series. Many of you have it, and the royalties from that were very useful, but it sold over 4,000 copies, and it's not selling that many anymore after 7 years. And so membership is important, and if you do it now or do it in the mail in December, of course you can count it as a deduction this year. If you do it while you're here, you don't have to pay for the stamp. But we will take memberships all the way for this year, you know, well into the early part of next year, and we hope you will join. $15 base figures, $15 for individuals and $25 for a couple. Additional contributions welcome at all times. We are doing a pretty aggressive amount of community outreach now, and you know, costs some money, so we hope you have the support. Our primary activity, as usual, remains having programming. You have in front of you the entire 2016 schedule for all of our programs. We actually have someone signed up for 2017 already. So I'll just mention January, the president of the Penn Brewery is going to come and talk about the brewery and beer. We've had discussions about whiskey, but we've never had a discussion about beer. So we'll fill in a hole in January. In February, we have City Theater coming, an institution that's not in Squirrel Hill, but many, many of you attend, and I thought it'd be nice to get a history of that, rather long history now. So that's what, we also do walking tours in the summer, and we'll be doing Frick Park, but that's down the line. I think that unless some of the officers or others have anything else to say, I think we'll go into our program now. Unless there are any questions about the organization before we get into that.
We did change the October date.
If you'll notice, by one of the advantages of having our schedule out early is that one of our members saw the schedule and said, you know, your October meeting is the height of Yom Kippur. That's nine months early, they told us that. And so we've changed it, and got that all arranged. By the way, a cute story, the minister here, Michael Foley, asked to speak, and he said, of course, you know, such a nice host. And then I said, what would you like to speak on? And we're going to have a little bit far-ranging speech. It's not quite Squirrel Hill. We're going to hear about St. Francis of Assisi, because he's taking a group of his parishioners there this spring, and he's going to tell us about that. I thought that would be a different kind of a talk. We moved to Pittsburgh in 2000, year 2000, and bought a house, an old house, 1907, that needed a bunch of renovation. And one of the features of this house was some very nice and in very bad shape stained glass windows. One of the first of a number of contractors and artists that we met in that year was Glenn Greene, our guest this evening. And Glenn did a marvelous job for us in refurbishing and also adding some other windows in the house. So it's a personal pleasure to have Glenn come tonight. You know, his store, his fabricators are in Regent Square, seen the sign along Braddock. It's been there for many years now. Glenn's going to talk about his craft, and he's going to talk about the history of his company and how he got into this interesting field. And as you can see, we're going to get a bunch of examples. This is not a short talk tonight. Glenn's put a lot into it, so expect to be here for a bit. Glenn, thank you and welcome.
I'm hoping I can be heard without the microphone, so I don't have to hold it. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for coming out. Thanks, Michael and Squirrel Hill Historical Society. Happy holidays to everyone. We put some good time into this exhibit, and we're going to talk about my history of a career of stained glass as an artisan and a preservationist. We're going to start off with a short video that my friend Tanner Lang made earlier this year for a project he did at Point Park University called 90 Neighborhoods. After the video, we're going to go right and look at a bunch of the work I did just this last year. And then we're going to start right from the beginnings of my, basically my life, and work my way through my story. Okay, you ready? Show the video.
Hi, I'm Glenn Greene, owner of Glenn Greene Stained Glass Studio, Inc. here in Regent Square, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I do stained glass creations and restorations. I make stained glass.
Pittsburgh, and
Moved to Regent Square last year. It didn't take long after meeting Glenn or experiencing the atmosphere in the studio that I realized I wanted to be a part of the effort he's got going here. I was drawn to stained glass. Always like to use my hands, and I think making a physical product is pretty impressive.
To hear, yep. And the whole thing, and then, you know, Dremel, what they have there too. And then you gotta be lots of bluffs and super patient.
Learning from an expert, it's kinda cool to see the effect of stained glass on other people, because I think the artwork really does have such a positive impact on someone's day-to-day life. So I really see how he gets his passion and where he pulls that from, because not only is it preserving this historical part of Pittsburgh, but he's kind of contributing to some new dialogue, adding a little flavor to the art.
I've done a lot of projects in Regent Square where people show me the trust and give me the freedom to do my art. I'm really all about here and now. So when I create things or restore things, it's to make life good right now. With me tonight, you saw in the video, Troy Novak. Good helper. Well, the first up on our presentation for the looking over what happened this last year is a series of art pieces I did. I call it Caution Wordplay at Work. So all the titles and the themes are a little bit funny. And I do some of my series, I'll do them in a row. I don't start a piece and let it hang and then start the next piece. If I do a series, I'll finish the piece and move on to the next one. So I did six pieces in this series, and they're in some, you see it only so well in the photo, but it's old pine frames. They came to me from a church in Millvale. Beautiful old pine, they had a lot of paint on them, strip them, sand them, refinish them. And the first one is called New Clear Energy. You see where that's a play on words?
Yeah, we get it.
All right, next one. And this is the one we saw in the video, called Hard Rock Show Window. It's basically an abstraction of a rock band on stage. There's three agates there, are the two guitar players and a bass. Then we've got another agate that's a keyboard player, and we've got a drummer in the back, and lights coming down, which would be your stage lights, and the little black Mardi Gras glass, they call that, is sort of like your audience. And those particular agates, I use a lot of rocks and agates in my work. I have become friends with a fellow named Carl Wagenauer, and he actually cuts and polishes his own rocks. So these are more like homemade rocks, and thanks to Carl for giving me a bunch of his rocks. Okay, next we got Sophisticated Goofballs. I told my girlfriend today I was a sophisticated goofball, and she said I could drop the sophisticated. Okay, next. Strained Grass Window. This one, my neighbor John, who's here tonight and loves my work, him and his wife Ruth, he took one look at that and his eyes got pretty wide, and turns out it fits one of his windows in the back of his home. It looks like I spent hours trying to make it fit there. It fit in so nice. And he's right across the street, so I can actually look out the window of my studio and catch a little bit of that window. And it's nice to see. And John's a great neighbor and a great guy. And so is his wife and his son, Max. This one, it's a thin line between art and window. Two nice pieces of some pretty nice specialty glass. It's pretty much what you see a lot of in the world. You got your land and your sky. Recurring themes are earth and sky. I do a lot of windows like that. We're using a lot of old window glass this year. Old window glass, you might know, some of it's hand blown or more handmade. It has a lot of imperfections and bubbles, and you can't see it in the photograph, but in the center there's a very thin line coming right down the middle. And this is the sixth and final piece in the series. Sorry, I make no apologies. It actually picks up the themes from the other five windows. So they're all put in there. And that's that series. I actually have nine oak frames that I'm continuing the series. I just finished the first in that series today. The continuation, I should say, and it's called The Angels in the Details. After our slideshow, I brought a number of pieces, and that's the first one we'll look at, is sort of the continuation of the wordplay at work. Okay. This is a major restoration project we took on. You've got a picture of the full window. It's probably about 5 foot by 9 foot. It's a big, giant window. There's one pretty prestigious mansion down in Braddock, PA, owned by the, what was that magnate's name? What's his first name?
Charles
Schwab was a magnate from back in the day, and the owner calls it Schwixen because our local doctor fellow, Dr. Bruce Dixon owned it, and then he bought it after Bruce passed away. And the John Hempel has been fixing it up, and I know John, so we got the talk in, and we set up a scaffold, and the window's too much of a monster to pull out without a lot of effort. So we've been pulling out all these panels a couple at a time. The whole bottom of the half of the window we restored this year. It was quite the challenging project, and quite interesting. This piece is called Pop Art. So it's basically a stained glass stop sign, and it's also, I have a theory that my art is sort of like pop art. And it's part of a series I've developed called Read Your Mind. If I come up with a theme that I like, I'll continue that theme and Read Your Mind. Get it? R-E-D? Okay, what do we got next? This was a very fun project we did up in Edgewood. Unfortunately, they sort of got one of those cheesy Home Depot doors in the middle. And then the original entryway, it's pretty rough. The three transom panels are all the original, and they're still pretty rough. They're probably going to hire me next year to fix those up. They wanted to just replace them all and put new stuff in, but I convinced them to let me save. You can see there's the original border, and then the tops and bottoms are still the original. We took them all apart, re-leaded them. And the center bevel's original too, and then we put all this abstracted art with a garden theme. Their whole front yard at the home is garden theme. I love to work with clients. We just discuss, you know, go back and forth about what to do. I do it, put it in, pull out the old ones, completely redo them, and put them in. Very fun project. I did this project for the Campbells, who live right around the corner from the last job, the Crumholes. And these were two interior cabinets. They actually are a bit farther apart in their dining room, and they're backlit. They have agates in the center. I'm one of the few people, you rarely see folks that do stained glass that it's not pre-designed. Generally, with the stained glass window, you'll have a piece of paper with a pattern on it. Everything's pre-designed. The only thing that's pre-designed about these is the two rocks in the center. And the theme, and I discuss a lot with the client what kind of glass, and I visit their home and look at the space. And everything else, I'm cutting a couple pieces at a time, maybe, and I trace around the piece, and I continue, and each piece is done. It's almost more like spontaneously painting with the glass. I've only seen a couple other people do that, and not too much. I do it a lot. This project happened right after the Campbell's cabinet doors, and gosh, they're almost exactly the same size, so that was kind of a coincidence that these folks called me up and hired me to do this. It's a couple, Barrett and Becky and their daughter, They live up in Highland Park in a beautiful home. It's a rare kind of home because it hasn't been touched much. It's very original. And these were in their second staircase landing. They actually are together like that, in their second staircase landing leading up to the third floor. And originally they just had window glass. And as they said, it was kind of boring. So we jazzed it up a little bit. This one with the two agates to the right on the right and the left on the left is some old recycled painted pieces. Those are probably Civil War era. Back in the Civil War era, they did a lot of silk screening of repeated patterns on glass. And I love to recycle old stuff. I have piles and piles of old glass. I just collect it and hoard it and box it, and then I turn around and use it again. This is the front of the YMCA up in East Liberty. And it is just about, the project's just about done. They're turning it into the Ace Hotel. The folks from the Ace Hotel, their home office is in Portland, Oregon. They're what you call a boutique hotel. I think they have about 8 or 10 locations. I think Seattle might be the first one. They're in Portland, Palm Springs, New York, London, Panama City. Now Pittsburgh. They heard about what was going on. Some local folks contacted them and thought they'd do well in East Liberty since it's becoming so hip and all that. Some folks from East Liberty contacted them and they agreed and they bought this YMCA building, and it's just about done. It's about to open. So this is the exterior. My piece is right on the interior. Go ahead, Troy. There's the piece I did. This just completed this panel. If we go back and forth a couple times, you see the three areas here that are really intricate in the original carved stone. And then you see that, you can see where I got my idea. They gave me complete artistic freedom. These folks were, they wanted to know what I was going to do. All I had drawn up on this was the wide lead, the grid area, and the tree line. And then I did a couple idea sketches on the abstraction areas. But those, they really set me free, and I was able to do my spontaneous thing with them. I picked up some of the neighborhood. I really got the feel of the East Liberty. The area on the right here is the library. Then to the left of that, I don't know if you folks can see the brown area, or if anybody familiar with that sculpture across the library. It's like a fountain sculpture. That's represented there. You got the little bit of that fountain, and I put a pretty wide rectangle. It's like a fountain window. The center has ideas about East Liberty Presbyterian Church is right across the street. So there's a Gothic arch kind of in the corner there. To the right, there's sort of a tower. And then there's some other ideas, blue and white for William Pitt. And on the left, the bottom left, you see that is picking up that water tower. Everywhere you go in East Liberty, I've always been fascinated by that water tower. It looks like a big spaceship or something. And it sits in that tree line. A lot of times you see it, and the bottom is a tree line. And then the wide lead really picks up their windows. Go ahead, Troy, go back. See these windows? All their original windows have these divided mullions in them. So I really was able to pick up the feeling of the building and the neighborhood, and they're thrilled with it, and it was quite a good project. They're opening up soon, so I hope you all get a chance to visit and check it out. Here I am standing in front of the window. All right, well, that was 2015, and now we're back to truly the beginning of my stained glass consciousness. This is Bethel Synagogue in Akron, Ohio. I spent the first 7 years of my life in Akron. And that was the synagogue that I belonged to as a little kid. I actually went to kindergarten and first grade there. Get to my notes here. I would say a pretty significant thing about this, I think, put stained glass in my mind for sure. You know, going to temple and seeing this big window. This is actually, they just moved. They built this whole new building to house this window. They moved about 3 miles down the road to the Akron Jewish Center grounds, put up this whole new building. Of interest also, when I was just a little boy, we moved out of Akron when I was 7, we moved to Cleveland. And my grandparents owned a light fixture store in downtown Akron. So I think that got into my consciousness too, when your grandparents have a showroom with a bunch of crystal chandeliers and Tiffany shades and at that time lava lamps and things of that nature. I think that got into my consciousness, just the whole, you know, light and stained glass. And also my grandpops used to come and pick me up on Sunday mornings when I was pretty young, probably 4, 5, 6. Sunday mornings he would go out and hang light fixtures for clientele. And I got to go, he would come pick me up and we would go out and do these installations, and most of the clientele would dote over the cute little grandson and all that, but I think getting into homes like that and installing, I mean, that's sort of a shades of things to come, you know, because I go out now as an adult and install like crazy. Okay, what do we got next? Okay, this is Al Brickle from New Daystar Glass. This is the owner of the first studio where I got my apprenticeship. Al was my upstairs neighbor when I was just a tyke, and he had this studio, I think he opened in 1970, and my mom actually took the stained glass class, and even as a young kid like that, I think it was probably around 72 by the time mom was taking the class, and I got to hang around in the studio, and it was quite interesting, and he was our upstairs neighbor, so I knew this fellow, it was still getting into my brain that I was destined to be a stained glass guy. Next slide shows, this is world's largest kaleidoscope, 1972. So this was in the gallery at the studio of my mentor, and you stick your face into the one end, it's 12 foot long, and you stick your face into one end, and it's got like a little ship's wheel on it, and you know, you can keep a little kid, a little 9-year-old, 10-year-old, stays pretty busy putting his head in there and turning the wheel, and it's a pretty big image. I wish we had more pictures of the image or what was created, but it was very neat. He had that put, by the time I went to work for him in 1979, he had it stowed away in his basement. And then much later on, when kaleidoscopes were getting popular in the 80s, somebody wrote a book about kaleidoscopes, and they heard about this kaleidoscope, and the author's children looked up Al Brickle, had him dig it out, and they purchased it from him. And I was in a bookstore. I wasn't in contact with Al at that time, but in the early mid-80s when this book came out, I was in a bookstore and saw this book about kaleidoscopes, started leafing through it, and it was like, my mentor is the centerfold. There he was, right there with his kaleidoscope. Okay, this is New Daystar, by the way, means it's a Middle English for the morning Daystar. We used to tease them, it became New Disaster, we were teasing them. And here I am with the crew, that's me, I'm a little overexposed there, probably about 16 there. Jeff on the right, Joni, Sheila was Al's partner, and Mike. And I'll tell you what, very fortunate to work with these people because they're all super nice. I love them all dearly, super talented. I mean, they just taught me, you know, I was there 3 years through high school, and boy, did they teach me a lot. I just learned a lot, and good people, and good skills. I was, I started in 10th grade. I was at the public high school on the work program, which means I went to school for half a day, and then I had to get a job. The first semester, I had a busboy dishwasher job, and it was getting close to Christmas vacation, and I said to my mom, "Mom, I gotta get any other kind of job." And she said, "Oh, well, you know, Al moved up to our neighborhood. His studio, we lived way closer to downtown, and so was his old studio, and then moved up to the Cleveland Heights area." And she said, "You know, he moved up to town." I toddled myself down there, and I walked in. I said, "Hey, Al, remember me?" And he says, "Of course." And I said, "Boy, I need a job." And he said, "Oh, sure, you're hired. Hey, you want to be an artist? Here's a broom." I mean, old-fashioned. I scrubbed the toilet, took out the garbage. Really was the start of the low man on the totem pole. Okay, these are a couple images from my time. My original portfolio, I want to look up Sheila and some other folks from the New Daystar and get some more pictures, because my portfolio was actually stolen out of our vehicle in New York City a few years later. But this piece on the left, I did as a senior in high school. I called it Lunar Impressions, and I still have that piece. That's the only piece I have from my three-year apprenticeship. The drawing on the right was my very first pattern. It's kind of like a New Daystar. It's a big, giant sun. It was super colorful. I finished it. I went home, and they called me on the phone and say, "Hey, Glenn, there's somebody here who wants to buy it. You know, usually you keep your first panel. You want to let it go?" I was like, sure, go ahead, sell it. Unfortunately, I don't have a photograph. So if anybody out there in YouTube land or the interwebs knows where this piece is, I would really love to have a photograph. This fella, we're going to show a few folks from California. In the late 60s, early 70s, there's books written about it, and some of these artists are pretty famous. There was a real movement of modern stained glass. We did a lot of modern, we were basically the modern studio of Cleveland. New Daystar Glass, we restored a lot, and we did a lot of traditional designs, but they did a lot of experimental artwork, a lot of modern stuff, and they actually had this fellow, this Dan Fenton, who I just found out when we were doing the research for this, he passed away. Also, Al Brickell passed away in 2010, and Dan Fenton passed away in 2012. But he was a super interesting guy, and he used to travel the country doing workshops in studios. So way back, probably around 1980, 81, he came through and did a four-day workshop at the studio. And we did a lot of interesting stuff. He went through everything, all these different techniques. The Cleveland studio was set up like with all these advanced techniques. They had beveling machinery. We did wheel engraving, etching, acid etching, sandblasting. We even resilvered mirrors. I would strip and hand pour old mirrors that were messed up. We had kiln. We bent glass. We painted on it. Just anything you can imagine they had set up for glass. And this Dan guy went and showed all these modern techniques and had slideshows like this and lectures and talked all about the modern movement. I have been studying that in magazines. When I was a kid, I couldn't read enough about glass. I went to the library, checked out every book I could find possibly on glass, read up on the chemistry and the history, industrial glass. I just got bit by the bug. Matter of fact, Dan Fenton, they had a thing out in California, they called it Glass Madness. I think they even had like an art piece about, you know, like basically getting bit by the bug. My father moved out to San Francisco. Dan was from Oakland, California, and my father had moved out to San Francisco right before I got my job. So I was really drawn to San Francisco, and this is another California artist that's been a big influence on my work, Peter Malaga. And then the next guy, Narcissus Quigliotta, is pretty much the top name, sort of a modern Tiffany. As far as modern art, this guy was really in all the buzz and all the talk. He was in San Francisco. This is a picture of one of his installations. I've actually seen that from the outside. When I ended up leaving Cleveland and moving to San Francisco, was trying to make my way there. Backtrack a little bit. When I was at the public school and was on the work program, that was 10th grade. By 11th grade, I discovered this school, alternative education. It was called CULC, Cleveland Urban Learning Community. And I ended up going there for 11th and 12th grade. And it was basically like being homeschooled or self-taught. I had to go out and you know, design my own programs and teach myself or learn from people. And I had to write out what I was doing and show that I was learning. And I basically was self-taught or learned from other folks and got all my credits to get out of high school. But that afforded me to go full-time. I didn't have to show up at CULC much. I was basically in night school. And nights and weekends was high school. And one of the teachers at Cleveland Urban Learning Community knew this woman that was apprenticing with Narcissus. He had no paid helpers. So I got hooked up with this gal, Cheryl Cotlier, that was his apprentice. And when I went out to San Francisco, she got me an interview with him, and I was offered an apprenticeship to work with him. And I really wanted to, but there was a strict contract, 2 years, 5 days a week, absolutely no pay. And I was too poor and too restless. So I ended up working for some other studios out there for a few weeks, or piecework, and really had a great experience out in San Francisco, and fully intended to stay out there. Another great thing that happened to me in San Francisco was right when I got there, there's a art museum in Gold Gate Park called the DeYoung Museum, and they had an extremely extensive Lewis Comfort Tiffany exhibition. So right when I got there, I got to see this. I had seen him at the stuff at the Metropolitan in New York City. I had seen the displays there of the Tiffany, but this was a giant exhibit, and that really kind of blew my mind, really, to see all that old stuff. The interesting thing about Narcissus, too, was he really poo-pooed anything old. He was so modern, and it was the first time I heard all this, we're going to stretch the limits, and we're going to forget about everything old, and I thought that was cool, but as you'll see, I kind of stick with, I don't think there's any, my thing is mixing old and new. I don't have any problem appreciating history and bringing it to the here and now. Most of you people probably recognize this, Grand Concourse. What I want to show now in the next few slides is, so I'm living in Cleveland, and grew up in Cleveland, but I had a Pittsburgh connection as a child. I had my mom's first cousin, her husband, and their three daughters lived just down the street here, 1526 Murray Avenue. And they lived in a beautiful house with a elaborate beveled glass entryway and one of these big giant staircase landing stained glass windows and bay windows, and just a beautiful home. Their home blew me away, and we would come down here every other year for Thanksgiving. They would come up and see us, you know, the next year, and we would come down here. And we would sometimes, you know, stay another day, and we would take a couple trips around Pittsburgh. And I started to realize Pittsburgh, you know, when you walk into this place, if you like stained glass, you're kind of like, wow, that's a lot of stained glass. And then we went to other places. We went into the Cathedral of Learning and saw all those nationality rooms, and it's pretty impressive space, and there's lots of leaded and stained glass in there. And we also went to Heinz Chapel, of course. Interesting thing about Heinz Chapel is, if you didn't know this, it has the tallest singular windows in the United States. Mm-hmm. To get taller windows, you got to go to Europe, to the old medieval windows. A real interesting precursor to my life to come here in Pittsburgh also is that I ended up doing a large project on top of the Cathedral of Learning at the Honors College. They redid it in 2003. I have a slide here of the installation up there. I did about 40 windows up there. Most of them were kind of like the windows in this room, just regular leaded rectangles. But they let me put my art in the center of them, and there's also in the reception desk is a nice medallion. And there's another detail. I always liked some of these details in the windows at Heinz. The Charles Connick, pretty famous artist. Charles Connick started in Pittsburgh at the Rudy Brothers stained glass. And then he moved his studio and got his own studio in Boston. And here you see Abraham Lincoln kind of freeing the slave. You got the slave master over there, and Abraham is freeing the slave. There's all kind of really interesting stuff like that in those Heinz Chapel windows. If you haven't been to Heinz Chapel, it's usually open. It's a great place to visit. So this is right across the street from Heinz Chapel. I don't know if any of you remember this church. It was a Belfield Presbyterian church. My brother was at Carnegie Mellon. This is 1981 was his freshman year. So 1982, he ran into a fellow that was living in the church and doing volunteer work. I think he had a stipend, like room and board in the church. and he was restoring the windows. This front set, this servo here, he had a big scaffolding set up on there and was had a system to take the windows out, put them in crates, and lower them down off the scaffolding. He had a room on the side. He was doing the restoration work right in the church. And my brother ran into this fellow, and he wanted me to help with the project, which was basically volunteer. So that was my first project. I thought I was going to be here like 2, 3, 4 weeks maybe. This is another interesting, really old photograph. This is looking from Webster Hall, and you see the old Belfield Presbyterian right there. And then the next shot shows you what it looks like today. They tore down a few historic landmarks from Oakland, like the Syria Mosque, which used to have a ton of stained glass. It's a real shame, a real travesty, if you ask me, that they tear down these old buildings. I know they cost a lot to fix, but I think that's pretty, it's nice they left the tower, huh? So yeah, I worked at that place for a while, and I started just repair work started falling into my lap. I had found a free place to stay down in Oakland. There's where my first studio ended up being. Some people I met became friends with had a big old apartment, had this teeny little room off the side, wouldn't let me pay rent. And I was able to set up a little table in the basement of this apartment and I just started picking up repairs and doing sort of freelance repairs. And I still didn't think I was going to be staying long. But then I went down to this place, was in Butler Street in Lawrenceville, called Phoenix Stained Glass. They're long gone, they're long out of business, but I called them up on the phone and went down to get some supplies for some repairs, and they're like, "Oh, you repair, huh? They hired me on the spot." So I spent the next 2 years at Phoenix Stained Glass. A guy named Bernie Robbins ran that place, a very intense fellow. He did 2 tours in Nam, Vietnam, Special Forces. He was quite the interesting, skilled character, and I learned a lot from him. I learned incredible amounts there. We did an incredible amount of work. We had restored a Tiffany window from Allegheny Cemetery. We restored this thing, put it back in, and there was some kind of crazy thing. They lifted it was in a mausoleum, and somehow something weird happened. I think they lifted like an 800-pound copper or brass door or bronze door off this mausoleum and stole a thing. It was pretty much a travesty about that, but restoring the windows. And he knew a lot about stained glass. He had owned a studio up in Boston area. What's that called, Brad? What's that area where you're?
Berkshires?
The Berkshires. I think he actually had outside of Boston, he had a stained glass studio in the Berkshires. Ended up in Pittsburgh, and his shop eventually kind of went under, and this is my original storefront. This was on 5th Avenue, just below Kraft is that crazy bend. Mm-hmm. And I had my apartment that I was telling you about was just a few doors down here, and one day I was coming home from Phoenix off the Big Hill, Robinson Street's the Big Hill up behind Pitt, and that comes down. And if you had lost your brakes on Robinson Street, you would have hit my old shop. I'm coming down there, and it was all boarded up at the time, real rough, all no windows, all boarded up, and there's a giant for rent sign on there. At the time, the landlord ran the business just the next door here. At the time, I was paying a management company. It was called Golden Company. I don't know if they're still around. I never hear them anymore. But I was writing my rent checks, which was super reasonable, by the way. I was writing my apartment rent checks to, oh yeah, the folks that had that apartment, they moved out. I ended up with that apartment. So here it is. I have my freelance and my own work in the basement. I'm working for Phoenix Stained Glass. I'm coming down off the hill, and there's the big for rent sign. I went and asked their landlord, "Hey, is that your storefront?" And he says, "Yeah, it's my storefront." I said, "Let me take a look, huh?" So he lets me in. It was an American Legion post, the Crispus Attucks American Legion post. Anybody know who Crispus Attucks was?
Yeah.
So the first guy killed in the Revolutionary War. Right. Happened to be an African-American. So, man, the place was tore up. The Legion Post had moved out, and they left it pretty rough. There's all kind of stuff in there, and he wants to rent it to me. And, I worked a deal with him, and I rented it very inexpensively, very, very inexpensively. And I had scored a show at the University of Pittsburgh. Their student union had a beautiful gallery they used to have art shows in, all these windows. So it was a perfect gallery for a stained glass show. And I had somehow gotten this show, and it was upcoming, so I wanted more room than just the basement to make pieces for this show. I didn't plan on opening a business there. I opened it there. I planned to do freelance and keep working for Phoenix. I was very happy at Phoenix. They paid me on a contract basis. The harder I worked and the quicker I got the pieces done, the more money I could make. His business eventually failed. I had scored a lot of work from that show at Pitt. Ended up having another show the next year. I started getting more and more freelance. And Phoenix Stained Glass started to fade out, and I think they were out of business like a year or so later after I ended up having my studio. You can see we did a pretty nice paint job on the front there. Anybody remember that store?
Yes.
Okay. I was there 12 years. It says up there, 1984, 1986, or 96. Okay, what do we got next? This was a window I made at the old studio. I rented it in 84, I think 85. I made this window for Heights Jewish Center up in Cleveland Heights. It's actually my parents' synagogue. And it's over the arc, and it's backlit. There's no windows in this room, so it is the serious focal point of the room. The Ten Commandments tablets on an imaginary stone wall with the distant mountains and the sky and this. The stone trellis becomes a Star David pattern with the little grapevines wrapped around it. The grapes are those little nuggets that you see in grape lamps or windows, little nuggets. And usually when you see one of those Tiffany lamps, it's the little nuggets like that, they're just bunched together. We actually ground them to fit around where the leaves, and you can't see it in this photo, but where they fit together, they needed to be ground and fit. They fit a pattern. That was a lot of extra work. And all these individually cut pieces for the Hebrew writing of the Ten Commandments, that's a lot of work. Another interesting thing about this window, on the bottom, there's a little windowsill that's about 6 inches deep. There's a little ledge or sill, and I created a little three-piece light cover. You can kind of see it in this photo. You know, over the arc is always an eternal light in synagogues. They always have a light on. Somewhere in the temple is a light, and the eternal light is actually built into the window. So here the lights are on inside, it's backlit in this photo. But when those lights are off, there's always a light down on the bottom there. This church, St. Agnes, was right across the street from my old studio. So I thought that'd be interesting to show that. They had a rectory building up to the right here, and I had done some work, I had done some repairs on the rectory, and they had let me in this church a few times. It had giant marble columns going down the row, a big rose window up top. They had windows going up the sides. That was traditional, very traditional sort of medieval style church glass. I never worked on there much, but I got in there. And one of the old timers in the neighborhood said that there's the whole row of giant marble columns. One of the old timers I had met said he saw those columns brought in on horse and wagon. Another church down at the old studio was St. Peter's. Anybody remember that? Fifth Forbes and Craft? At the time, this was the oldest standing church in Pittsburgh. Historic landmark. They ended up tearing this thing down to put up some, office thing or whatever, Oxford Development or whatever, and it's being torn down. All that stained glass was in there. This was the oldest standing church in Pittsburgh. I can't believe they tore it down. There was a fuss. There was a whole movement to save it. And they couldn't save it. They tore it down. I'd done a bunch of work there, too. Well, there was one window in there that had been busted out by some vandals. A couple other projects, I had restored that, made a relationship with that congregation and such. When they demolished this church, the demolition company took out all the windows. Real tough removal because they're not in wood or metal or anything. Every now and then you see these windows that are set in stone. And the one I did was set in stone, and I chiseled it out by hand. And I want to tell you, that was a knuckle scraping event. No fun to chip out a stained glass window from a stone wall. and then you got to take it out, and then when I put it back in, I had to get masonry, I had to become a mason, and set it back in with the cement. But they came up with, they had like what was like a big masonry circular saw. Like you see them cutting sidewalks? There was this guy with a mask up there cutting these things out, and they took out all the windows, and they took out ads, and there's all these people flocking to there to buy these windows. They should have just come down around a corner to my place, because these windows were beat. And I ended up getting, I think I had three clients that bought these windows off the demolition company, and they hired me to restore them. I could have made them new ones for a little less money. But these folks restored these big church windows and set them in their homes. They look pretty nice. Well, here we are. You saw my new studio that I moved to in Regent Square. You saw that in the video. So we don't have another slide of that, but here's probably my first giant commission up there. It's four windows for Temple Ohav Shalom, which is in the North Hills. I had actually had a relationship with them. They were in an old church building on Duncan Avenue, and I had done some little repairs on their windows there. And then they bought a racquetball court up on Thomas Run Boulevard or Thomas Run Road. And I got hired to do these. When these are 4 foot by 9 foot, I met with the committee a few times to do this design. The only thing I really had with the design was the border, which is the 12 tribes of Israel are represented. They're in, supposed to be inlaid stone on a stone window border, and then you have another border down on the bottom, which is also supposed to be a stone, imaginary stone window frame. So on the bottom, you sort of have their images from the Sabbath, which is sort of your everyday, normal thing. So that's what I had drawn in. There's a spice box, the challah bread, the wine cup, and the Sabbath candles. So that imagery was all drawn, and then I had the circle with the Star of David. Up at the top is a sun, a moon, a couple plants, and a comet. So these imaginary, you know, stone representation window frames were drawn in. And then the rest, I just had the concept. When I was hired for the project, the concept we settled on was doing the seasons. So reading right to left like Hebrew, you've got winter, spring, summer, and fall. I'm sorry, we got that. We just did this PowerPoint. We got it messed up. So fall and winter are switched. Winter should be over here. There's the fall. And there's a little representation of the Jewish holidays within the season. Summer doesn't really have any major holidays, so I put the Tree of Life in there, a peace dove, and the Lions of Judah. You can't see it too well in this photograph. You might be able to see, oh, the Ohav Shalom in Hebrew are both four-letter words, and I've got the letters snuck into these designs. Top says Ohav, and Shalom is written along the bottom there. And a very interesting project. Big, big windows. This is a project I did in the new studio. We're all in the new studio, by the way. This was at the Unitarian Church at Morwood and Ellsworth down in Oakland. On the right, you see the original windows that have been there forever. On the left is the window I did for them. The Unitarian symbol is the burning chalice. And they also have the seven principles. So you see the window got, this is a whole new installation. So I designed the wood opening and had that built. And then and put in the seven panels. It really picked up off the old church. You see these flowers. This transom here is leading from the main sanctuary down to this, what they call the Schweitzer room. This is in the Schweitzer room. So I picked up the chalice. You sort of can see let's go back to that last photo. You see that diamond pattern in these medallions. So you can't see too well in the photograph, but there's amber, clear, and green in the diamonds, and I really picked that up. It's got an imaginary flower trellis and the medallion with the burning chalice. And then the bottom, there's sort of like a stone wall. The church is stone. You can see a little bit of stone out there, back door there. Another interesting thing about this window is it used to be exterior. This is when they did their remodeling. They hired me to do this window. That space used to house this thing that was all wood dividers with just colored glass put in, no lead,
and then there was an etched image of Albert Schweitzer. And I had actually been out there to repair that window a few times. Then they tore that all out, and I put in that window. Very fun project. The Unitarians were just so much fun to work with. They gave me a lot of artistic freedom, and it was a great project. But here we are up on top of the Cathedral of Learning, the 36th, 35th floors. This is the Honors College. It was, I guess it had been remodeled in like 1962 or something like that. Bad drop ceilings, bad lighting. So here it is, you got a prime space, but the decor was left a lot to be desired. So Ken Doino with the Rothschild Doino Architecture Collaborators. He's an old friend of mine. He was actually my next door neighbor when I moved to Regent Square. He got me involved in this project, and I worked with him pretty closely on this. It was a lot of fun. I need some better pictures of this. I think we got another shot here which shows a little bit more what's going on. Yeah, on the left you have that reception area panel. There's what they call a quatrefoil. I have a Four Seasons theme in here, which is you're going to see in another project. The Four Seasons at the Cathedral was comes up in another project. Over here, these were multi-layered laser-cut steel. Picked up the quatrefoil as well. Modern laser-cut steel, very nice railings they put in. At first, they had these little coins put in the center there, and they kept wanting to. Karen Billingsley, who is the assistant dean at the Honors College, she kept really wanting, pushing for me to do the medallions in there. The project was in 2003. Eventually, in 2010, they got some donations. And they hired me to do these, all these, this is the railing, go back to the last one, last photo truck. Yeah, this is the one railing, and there's a whole other section where they connected the floors. I think there was like 15 medallions maybe, so all in the centers now have these little miniature intricate little glass pieces. You can see in this photo some of the glass. I need better pictures of all that stuff. Okay, now we're getting into a series of seven panels. I'm trying to remember what year that was. Charleroi Federal Savings and Loan down in Charleroi, Pennsylvania. I got hired to do seven panels depicting Pittsburgh, different Pittsburgh history landmarks. They were all in a row. They're all just, you know, in a row along this wall. It's pretty main drag, you can see, 2004. So this was pretty much right after the next year, after Cathedral of Learning, I had this pretty major job. They're about 3 feet wide. So I came up with a pretty traditional looking outer border. And then the center each had an image that was all pre-drawn, so this is all pre-designed. Once again, I get the freedom, the backgrounds of all the images were all created spontaneously, spontaneous abstractions that work with the image. And here you can see I got a couple etched pieces of glass and have Native American looking designs, and you've got a Native American family, you know, pretty much hightailing out of town on the river since we genocided them and all that. They're trying to get out of town. So that was the first one. They kind of read right to left, and we have them on the slideshow here in order. So the first one was Native Americans. Next one is a steamboat. And the left corner, bottom left, and upper right, I've got some recycled, repurposed, probably 100-year-old painted pieces. You can see these abstractions are pretty successful with the border and the image. Pretty intricate images. This was a very fun project. There's a coal barge. Next. What do we got next? This is a building called Old Main from Washington and Jefferson University. Next is, this should be the Cathedral of Learning next. Okay, here we go. As I said, the Four Seasons theme I had done at the top of the Cathedral of Learning the year before. Winter, spring, summer, fall, reading clockwise. There's some details you just can't see in this
There's some teeny tiny pieces at the top. In the very center, they have, at the Cathedral of Learning, they have these three, like, Gothic arch openings in the stone, and you will see the blue sky coming through those openings. You don't see it too well in this photo, but I got teeny little tiny pieces of blue in there that show the sky. And the Four Seasons was a lot of fun. Anybody know what that is? It's actually a big glass blowing furnace. A lot of glass. They actually had some pretty big glass industry. I got this from doing some research and seeing this actual furnace at a factory in Charleroi. On the right is the bucket. They have the bucket of water that they use to work with glass blowing. There's a lot of funky, some of this is rondelles. My friend Fig is a glass blower. Mike Manchifico, he's been nice enough through the years to give me some of his beautiful handmade glass. There's a number of pieces of that in there. You've got a handmade jewel I did on the left, a circle. Another old rondelle that's sort of cut up. You can hardly see in the upper left is a wheel engraving. That's a repurposed old wheel engraving in that. So there's a lot of glassy stuff going on in the glass factory. Next one should be a spell mill. Steel mill to non-Pittsburghers. Us Pittsburghers call them steel mills. And that's a steel mill there. There's a lot of, I wish I had a better photograph of it. The upper left there is these, I did a lot of research on how steel mills looked. And there's these cables coming in and railroad tracks. There's texture for railroad tracks and different roads that lead up there. On the left is sort of that Gothic arch is kind of like a one of those pots that would pour the molten metal, and that's, you know, very silver series orange glass there represents the molten steel kind of being poured out. Behind the molten steel is what I call crazy spaghetti glass. It's a texture you can't get anymore. You'd see it a lot, mostly clear. You'd see it as a privacy glass in bathroom windows, maybe institutional office doors. I don't know if we could see that too well. But it looked like a certain kinds of steel, all these little squiggly lines. Okay. Now we're into what I call the Great 48. The photo on the left shows all 48 pieces. These are 48 individual pieces I made. Did these in 2005. I had started making, they're all little pieces, they're all like 10 by 12, 12 by 12, 10, 12 by 14. And I had been doing a number, I worked with a guy at a place called Bethel Sash and Door. This old gentleman named Chip Block, pretty interesting name. He had been building window frames and doors for 50 years. He's kind of a one-man dynamo. He passed away, I think, in maybe like 3-4 years after this. He was just the best guy to work with. He knew everything about making window frames. 50 years of experience, just the nicest guy. He would, I'd order them, and he'd have them there in no time, and they were built to a T. All these amazing window frames and doors. So one day I asked him, I said, hey, Chip, do you have any scrap of these, all these window frames you're making over there? He said, yeah, I got scrap. And window frames are generally about 2 inches wide on the face. I said, what do you think about cutting down the width of those and making me some petite little frames to put my art pieces in? With the what they call the routed detail, which you see on the inside of a window frame, it's perfect for framing stained glass. You need a little thicker frame, too. You can't have a flimsy little picture frame that isn't finished on the back. So he started making me these beautiful little frames with four little pieces of trim all ready to hold the glass in. I just make an art piece, pop this trim in and nail it in, you know, said and done. So I decided to order a big backlog. I was making these pieces. They were successful. Folks were buying them up. So I ordered four sets of 12. They're all slightly different sizes. So in probably January 2nd or 3rd, 2005, I walk into the studio, and I'm like, I just had this thought to shirk my duties of whatever paying work I had and go ahead and pull one of these frames out and make an art piece, which is the upper left one, and I called it Regality Fantasy. Another play on words, I tend to do that. As I'm making that piece, the light bulb went off in my head, to do a timeline of stained glass, just do one piece after the other. Make myself do 12 a month. So the first 4 months of 2005, I did 12 pieces. They're all signed and dated and titled. Some of these ones on the right are the ones I have left. We got Onward Soldiers, Above and Below, and Green Building. There's a couple other ones I have left. Make a Tree Stand. See, it's 6 of 48. So they're all. I happen to have 6 and 7. Hey, Grace. That was number 7. The other two that we don't have pictures of here are currently on loan to the Point Brews restaurant. So if you go over to the Point Brews restaurant, you look up at their windows that are kind of up on top of their dining room. That's two other ones from that series. I actually have another 48 frames that have been sitting around for 10 years. I kind of want to sell the rest of these ones. So I've got what the two, three, what's seven left? Anybody wants one of these? We're wheeling and dealing so I can get to the next series. Come on down and get them. This photo is not showing up all that well, but this was a project I was involved in. This shows the original interior of a synagogue that was sort of in the alley below the old Civic Arena, up off of 5th. This is now demolished, and Console Energy Center is there now. Congregation Beth Hamadrash HaGadol.
Right.
They got bought out by Console. There's another picture of the original interior, 1965. They pulled out all the stained glass and crated it all up and hauled it down to my studio. My studio was overrun with the crates. You had the one in the roof line, interesting like pyramid in the roof line. There was one on either side. I noticed stained glass in synagogues and churches and stuff, so I used to park my car down there to go to the Civic Arena for concerts or hockey games. I always noticed that room and wanted to go in there. So they brought all those windows to my place, and Harry Levine Architects, with the money that they got from Console buying them out, the congregation bought a building just down the street on 5th, and they renovated this building to house the new temple. There I am on a scaffolding with the old windows being set into the thing that the architect designed to hold. They became interior windows. A lot of work. Here's the one side. You see all these windows in this like pyramid that he built, and then they had this upper thing on both sides that housed the windows that went down the side. I uncrated, cleaned, numbered, categorized. They all went back down there, uncrate them, set them all in. You can see that downtown, kind of where 5th splits off there at the end past Console. This is pretty impressive from the outside. This big giant, wasn't a roof line, now it's this big giant pyramid that you see. That was quite the interesting project. Can we back up to the scaffolding one for a second, Troy? Mm-hmm. So later, this is 2010. Later that year, I made my first trip to Israel, took my folks, and my folks took me and my daughter. And I looked on the website for the Hadassah Hospital, where the famous Mark Chagall, 12 Tribes windows are at. And I looked on their website and they said, oh, we're closed for renovations. You can't view the windows. So you can imagine my bummed outedness. I get on the website and I email them this picture. I say, look, I'm no stranger to synagogue construction sites. How about you let me in there? They email me back and say, even if we let you in, they're boarded up. Can't see anything. So I miss those. Interestingly enough, the last time I went to Chicago, I went to the Chicago Art Institute, has a big, giant, famous Marc Chagall window. They were closed for renovations too. So I have yet to see a Marc Chagall giant stained glass window in person. Here we have Road of Shalom. I've been involved there a little bit, not too much. I ended up doing these awards though. The front window is that arch top, and they hired me to do these. They came up with a Pursuer of Peace Award, and this little thing I came up with, it's in a very heavy, nicely done steel stand. This is the first one. It went to the Bishop David Zubik, Whoever is good working for peace, it's okay with me. I love work for peace. This is the anniversary of John Lennon being killed today. He's a major influence on my work. Certainly music. Sting Lab's very rhythmic. I ended up picking up the drums. I have a drum kit, play the drums. Love music. Music's a big influence. Rhythm and music. This is a pretty rhythmic piece here. I ended up making a bunch of these. They love this first one, and they're giving out one of these awards every year. I think they're set up for about 5-6 years. Just a little thing. It's just a teeny thing. Now, my old studio had two giant churches, and then the other church I worked in Oakland, and Hines Chapel and all this. This line is overexposed here. It's not showing up. The sign says Waverly Presbyterian. This is on the corner, one block from my new studio. Forbes and South Braddock. Big old, really interesting church. This has got a lot of stuff going on. A lot of my friends and neighbors, my next door neighbor when I moved in, she's a lifelong member of Waverly Presbyterian. Jeannie Bird and her husband Jim and their whole family have been members forever. So I've been pretty involved in this church. I've done a bunch of repairs on some of their, not the main sanctuary windows, but a lot of their little windows that need work. I've done a bunch of work and been involved with that community. Very bunch of nice people. A lot of friends and neighbors at that church. These two windows on the bottom and the staircase, they were pretty beat up. And I got the call to maybe fix them. And I said, well, what if I just give it to Glenn Greene Originals and donate them? And they said, oh, that's okay. So I don't have photographs of them right now, but I came up with these nature theme, Frick Park themes, and I just made them and donated them, and that was fun. Another interesting thing about this church, here I am from Cleveland. The first time I went into the main sanctuary, they're like, okay, here's the handout, the history of these windows. It's a fellow named R. Toland Wright from Cleveland, Ohio. So that kind of floored me, that here I am coming all the way down here from Cleveland and moving in Pittsburgh, and the fellow did the corner churches from Cleveland. I thought that was pretty neat. These, unfortunately, another interesting thing about this church, you can kind of see over the door is a little bit of that carved stone, and then the rest of it looks pretty stark. Well, the original Waverly Presbyterian, Waverly is a street about 5-6 blocks down, and that the original Waverly church is still standing there, and the congregation raised all this money to build this place. Well, guess when they raised it? 1928. So by the time 1928 and 9 comes around, they're in trouble to build this church. He had the Great Depression. They lost all their money. So it's really the stone. I bet they probably already paid for the stained glass, because that R. Toland Wright, I did some research. He went to Europe and studied the old medieval stuff. It is pretty authentic. It looks like something you see over in France or England or something. It's every single piece is painted, teeny little pieces, to the nth degree, all the religious iconography. It's on the lot pretty, if anyone's ever seen it, it's on the lot pretty strained angle. These windows here are all deep blue, and it faces due east. That's why it's on the lot. When the morning sun comes through the blue, look out, it is a sight to see. The windows, I always thought they were in pretty good shape. They called me over there last year to get up on a ladder and take a closer look. They're kind of rough. I'm resisting the temptation to get involved in the repairs, honestly, because it's just a little over my head for wanting to repair all that work. And then the other thing is, like St. Peter's down in Oakland, they are set in stone. And it's going to be, whoever gets them out of there and gets them back in is going to have it's going to be a bit of a nightmare. Also, some people came around and sometimes them do-it-yourselfers fixed them. There are metal T-bars in between some of these big tall panels. I'm inspecting them. Someone had come along and didn't like the look of the metal T-bar. They were putty, leaking. Someone took a sawzall or something and cut these things flat and put all this goop along them. There's nothing worse than restoring something that some do-it-yourselfer repaired first. I'd restore any panel in any shape that a do-it-yourselfer didn't touch. So there's a big giant goop line on some of these. It's a travesty. So that's kind of a nightmare repair. They're scrambling to raise funds right now. Also, on the inside of that church, it's very stark. All that gingerbread, they must not have paid for that yet. Because it is really stark. You don't see all the detail. Other church of this stature would have a lot of details in the wood, all the stuff. And, you know, it's a shame they didn't have a lot of fanciness. But on the other hand, me being really sensitive to the aesthetics, I'm looking at this and thinking like, wow, you know, it really does, without all that other busyness,
the stained glass really jumps out. It's really a beautiful church. Here I am just showing a little commission, just a little ditty. I was hired to do, it's about 12 by 12, and they said, we need a chunk of cheese that looks like it's in a church window. So I said, okay, I can do that. I wanted to show the soldiers and sailors because I can't find the picture of the window. Michael Kraus is the curator there, and he was actually a member of Temple El Hav Shalom. Super knowledgeable about the Civil War. I know he gave a talk here at some point. He was one of the speakers. He's become a friend, and he's a super nice guy. And he had bought this really interesting antique medallion. I can't remember right now. It had something to do with soldiers and sailors. And there's an interior transom. We pulled out this big space, and I built this big transom, added on to the thing he had. And I'll get a picture for it for next time. I need a picture of this one for the next time, too. This is Kollel Jewish Learning Center. I was hired to do the 12 tribes in stained glass. They've got six sets of two windows. This is on the right is the tribe of Naphtali. I'm trying to remember what animal that is. Antelope, I think. And the left, the tribe of Dan, is represented by a snake. I have pictures of this somewhere, but I wasn't able to find my digital photograph in time for this presentation. But that was a really fun project. All 12 tribes, they have to have an addition. It's up at Beacon and Murray. Local yokel stuff. This is a picture of the gatehouse on Butler Street for the Allegheny Cemetery. You can sort of see these little windows here. It's a like a cusped arch that comes up in two, and then there's a centerpiece. A friend of mine, Bill Marshall, got this job to replace all those windows. They were really beat up, I guess. So he had all these window frames made, pulled them all out, put them in, and he realized that the one frame he saw was a solid piece of walnut. The arch is not something like this. Usually you would have joinery work to get that mullion in there and make the three sections. Let's see the next picture. So this was, he cut off the frame. They have the big, long, tall frames. He cut it off and attached the piece of the original on the bottom. You can't see the frame too well in this picture. It's solid walnut. All that coming, the bottom is added from the side. But these mullions that come down, that arch, hand-carved walnut. So he shined it up all nice, stripped it, put a beautiful finish on it, came by, gave it to me as a gift one day. So I was like blown away by that gift. It was extremely generous and extremely nice. I set it up in my workspace, and I looked at it for about 6 months. The frame was so special. I'm like, sometimes I'll do that. I worked with a lot of old frames for my art. I'll set something there, and I'm like, well, what am I going to do with this? What am I going to do with this? It just has to sit there and gel for a while. And finally I came up with this thing. I got three old bevels in there, and all the glass around there, all recycled from repairs and stuff I collected. I have a recurring tree theme. I'm a bit of a tree hugger. So you got your ambers and greens and all old recycled stuff. Hopefully recycling something helps a tree somehow. Go back 1 second. That piece ended up getting sold to Karen Billingsley from the Honors College at the University of Pittsburgh. She couldn't get enough of the work. Her and her husband, Ron, she goes to see that work every day. I have a bunch of windows in their home that I did custom installation. They've also patronized me for, I think they bought the precursor to the Great 48. They bought a couple of those. And then this was the most recent one. She came in, and I'll tell you, you couldn't have a happier home. I couldn't ask for a better appreciator to enjoy that piece. These are a couple pieces I did custom for friends of mine over in the Regent Square area. It's hers and his, my friends Jeannie and Joe. There's a lot of symbolism for their family. I got a couple beautiful kids.
We just talked about the size. They're in their master bedroom. They've been wanting my work for years. They've come around, got a couple gifts for people, and we just, you know, I'm just friends of mine. They talk about it. Just had the gestate for a while, and completely spontaneously done. We just discussed the themes, the type of glass they want, and complete artistic freedom. All kind of, like I say, symbolism that that means stuff to them, and just a lot of fun. We did a repair earlier this year, over the summer. We did a repair across the street, and Troy and I were coming out of this job, and Jeannie's standing out front of her house. She said, "Glenn, they haven't gotten old. I can't, you know, I'm thrilled every day to look at them." This is a set of four 12 by 12 panels I just made for art's sake. It's the house series. These are all old bevels. They're very thick, and when you put a bevel on a thick old piece of glass, it's a little nicer than today's modern thin glass. So these are, I have a giant collection of old bevels. And this is the house series. They all go together. You got red, white, and blue, patriotic. And then the green means that it's patriotic to be environmental, is my opinion. The green one's the only one it sold. Still got the other three around. Here we got more of my funny wordplay. If you can have, you got a three panel, old recycled frame. We put a lot of work in, strip, sand, make it nice. Shameless self-promotion, the three things. And then, in parentheses, modest. So if you can be shameless and modest, I think that's a pretty good trick, right? I've actually got my initials snuck in here. I've got an old recycled painted piece with a G. My middle name is Frederick. This is going to come up later in the other, in the presentation. G. Frederick. And then there's a little G I found. You can hardly see in this picture. I hope you can see that. Lower right-hand corner is a little G that I found in a swirl in the glass. So Glenn Frederick Green, that's me. A lot of green in there, too, for the shameless self-promotion. Here we have a staircase landing window, which is going to look familiar to Michael Ehrman. Mm-hmm. Because it's on his staircase landing. That was the only picture I could find right now. I've restored two staircase landing windows and a set of dining room windows. And then I put in new, he had old windows on the, that's the first project I did for Michael and Asta Ehrman. Was the top was, the dining room double hungs, had original stained glass, which was really beat up, and the bottoms were open. So I had to pull them all out anyhow, restore the tops, and I created, new panels to go with the bottom ones, and it was a very fun project. Michael and Esther are very sweet, had a lot of fun doing that. I'm sorry I don't have a picture of it today. So that's sort of, I just showed you a bunch of my art. Now we're kind of getting into, I showed some restoration too, but now I'm just sort of showing a little bit of Pittsburgh history. Tiffany, you know, we went to the Shattered Notions exhibit at the Heinz History Center to get prepared or do some research for this talk. They have, it's all about the industry. Glass from colonial times was a huge industry here. Before steel, it was just a huge industry here for actual window glass. You know, PPG developed the first giant window glass, but even just hand-blown or more when they made it a more handmade window glass. Dishware, decorative glass. Pittsburgh was a huge glass mecca, bigger than anywhere in the U.S. So they had a lot of that in the exhibit, and they had Kathleen Mulcahy's, one of her blown glass things, and then they had this teeny tiny little glass display, a little church window by Pittsburgh Stained Glass, and then a sign of Rudy Brothers, next to nothing. It is difficult to find history about stained glass. I've restored like a gazillion windows around here, and none of them are signed, and you know, I just talked to a 70-year-old friend of mine that's been doing stained glass around here for 50-some years, and he didn't have a whole lot of info. I want to research it more myself. I've done some research, and I usually run into a whole lot of nothing, and none of the windows are signed, so I hope to, if I ever come back and talk or write a book, I hope to find out what's going on with all this. We got more here than anywhere. I don't know if you folks realize that, but there's more stained glass in the homes and the churches and the institutions around here. There's just more here than anywhere. I've traveled the United States pretty good. I think Chicago might be second. They had a lot of stained glass. Frank Lloyd Wright and a lot of the bevel glass for Star Up in Chicago. I just don't think there's any more, any place. It's in 80% of the homes around here. You just don't see that. Hence, I got stuck here. So this is that was Calvary Methodist. They have Tiffany windows, very famous Tiffany windows. They had a whole big fundraising thing and had them restored recently by Kirk Weaver, did the restoration with his company. A long time ago, they called me to look at this one. This one's up in the balcony, the Ascension window. Just below Jesus' feet here, this blue area. It was just jacked and it was falling out. So they called me up and said, Glenn, come on and fix our Tiffany window. I'm like, oh, great. I go on up, go up on the balcony, take a good look at it. I come back down and said, look, you got to hire a big, you know, major restoration. You're not just going to fix that hole. I'm not going to, like, mess with the hole and you know, patch this thing. You need to do it right. And they took my advice and they raised a lot of money and they got it done. They're all restored now. There is a tour. The gentleman that restored them, Kirk Weaver, I think it's December 18th. You can look online. He's going to give a talk and a tour. I think you got to pay a couple bucks. He takes you to this church. I was on that church a few other times. He got all this other stained glass. I did a couple spot repairs, but I never got any of the major work there. The next photo shows this Emmanuel Episcopal Church. It's right around the corner from Calvary. This is Henry Hobson Richardson. Architect. He's the guy that did the big stone courthouse downtown. These arches in the front hold three Tiffany windows, and that's part of that tour that's coming up as well. And there's the three Tiffany's that are in there. I think it's, I can't remember which Presbyterian, 6th Avenue Presbyterian. They're famous. Their Tiffany windows are famous, or maybe infamous. The congregation made Tiffany put a bunch of paint on the windows, and it's infamous in that he made them put in their contract that he didn't agree with that aesthetic and that he wasn't going to be responsible. They're nice windows, but not as good as a lot of the other Tiffany's. We've got a pretty good collection of Tiffany's in this town. And the other major guy, you know, Tiffany and Lafarge are responsible for the opalescent movement. Late 1800s, Lafarge, it's more like discovered than invented. The story goes, John Lafarge, and this is the fortune window in the Frick building downtown. Lafarge apparently held a perfume bottle to the sun, and he looked at it, and it was opalescent glass. And he's like, you know, up to that time, all these windows were what they call cathedral glass, which is transparent color, and the only way you got an opalescent effect was when they put paint on it. He looked at his perfume bottle in the sun, he said, Viola, well, we could figure out how to make sheets out of this glass, and it just the depth and the paint really look you can get with just the glass, not using the paint. That's why you see her hands and her face are painted, but everything else is just the glass. So that was the significance of John Lafarge discovering and starting to make opalescent glass. He was a more modest person. Tiffany, of course, had obscene amounts of money, so he ran roughshod over Lafarge's patents, and the rest is kind of history. This is the picture you get at the Shattered Notions exhibit at Heinz. This is their big exhibit of Rudy Brothers. Rudy Brothers was a very prolific studio around town. They were over in East Liberty, and they did some of the finest Victorian work. I think they did all kind of designs. You can't tell because they never signed any of them. I've discovered through some research. I know their style when I see it. I actually know, I don't know how many different studios, but I probably know like a dozen, give or take, styles. All these windows I've restored, I haven't done enough documenting, but I can say, oh, there's, you know, Studio A or Studio B. They have all these different looks to them. We're going to see some Rudy Brothers, some of their finer stuff. This is a before, one I restored, I think, 2 years ago. This is a home up in Edgewood, staircase landing. There's the after. This is one of the nicest Victorian windows I've ever worked on. Little roses in the corner, all these intricate little curlicues, little jewels. It's just, when you look at a Rudy Brothers Victorian window, it's kind of like, ah. This is a set of Rudy Brothers as well. They have little chunks. You can't really see in this picture, but there's this doll de Vere is the Dalle de Verre is French for wall of glass, and that's the kind of glass you see in churches where it's like at the Tree of Life Synagogue. They're inch-thick slabs that are chiseled and laid into a jig, and then they pour cement. So it's more like a cementous, inch-thick thing that you see. It's a little bit more of a budget. Well, Rudy Brothers would take these inch-thick slabs and chisel out these little chunks that you were able to wrap lead around, and they're really odd and look like broken shards of glass. And when the light comes through it, it refracts the light up really nice. These have a lot of that chunk glass in them. These are my neighbors one block down happen to have these Rudy Brothers, beautiful Rudy Brothers windows in their, they live on the first floor, and the other two units, divide up into a rental. So they had me pull these out and fix them up and put frames on them, and they hang them in their kitchen. That's one block down. All right, so we kind of did Tiffany and Lafarge and Rudy. Now we're into a guy I can really relate to. This is Frederick G. Scheibler. Remember I told you I was going to call him with the Glenn Frederick? So not only have I worked on a ton of this guy's buildings, this is Highland Towers on Highland Avenue. Beautiful. He's our progressive architecture. He's our local Frank Lloyd Wright. There's the front door of Highland Towers. Before they put plastic on this thing on the outside, I was out there. I've been restoring that thing since 83 when I worked for Phoenix Stained Glass. They just kept these were single pieces of glass that all came down, and they just kept getting, the paper boy kept hitting it with the newspaper, people kept kicking it. So I have to go out and patch the thing. Nigh unto impossible to get them out of there to repair. So I've patched this thing a bunch of times. The green is actually the old green one was a pretty thick, interesting casted glass. This is the Harder House. A lot of people around here call it the Mushroom House. If you're from around here, you might know it. It's up on Beachwood Boulevard. It kind of sat there in disrepair for a while, and they did a major restoration on it back in 2014. And the gentleman that got the job to restore it, I worked with him a bunch, does a lot of high-end home restorations. This place has details that are just over the top. They had to redo that roof, and just the story I heard about that was a regular nightmare. I ended up restoring, there's some hollyhock windows. These are the ones, I made these new when they redid the kitchen. This one in the Hard House kitchen cabinet doors. This was in the basement. They tore this all out, the Harder House. Beautiful old blue mirror. You see this blue mirror from the 30s, 40s, 50s, I think? I now have that blue mirror stacked up in my giant, wonderful stash of glass. I think that was a bonus for all the work I did on there. I love that blue mirror. I hope to get a chance to do some stuff with it. I thought since I'm here at the Squirrel Hill Historical Society, we should show the carved squirrel at the Harder House. They've also got a beautiful carved eagle on the stair post knoll, but this guy sits on the floor below these hollyhock windows. I don't know if we have a shot of that or not. It's beautiful hand carved. Yeah, the hollyhock windows are kind of snuck in on the left here. That's the front door, and you can sort of see the hollyhock windows. I had to restore those, and that was very, very touchy restoration. Glass all over this house. These patterns with the rondelle and the window glass. These ones on the bottom, there was just clear glass in there. They didn't know where this butterfly came from. It was just kind of sitting around there in the house. And it actually didn't fit. I had to work on it a little bit to get it to fit. Oh, it must have come out of here. So they hired me to fix the butterfly. I ended up having to adjust a little bit to fit in there. And then I created these two mushrooms. And there's a picture, a better picture before, like, pre-installation. But the butterfly was an original piece, and the mushrooms I created. It is, like, an honor and a privilege and a whole lot of fun to create stuff for Scheibler Houses, because he's just an amazing architect and character to spare in these houses. This is one of three houses in a row on Trevanian Street, right over by me in Regent Square. When you come down off the hill, kind of from Edgewood Town Center, you see this sitting up on the ridge. If you look over the old, over up where the old food land was, you see this guy sitting up there. Nancy and Paul Biancooley own this house. You see these windows in the basement along the driveway here. I filled all those with original art. They let me go and do my abstract thing in there. There's some other windows, there's some door windows. They decided they needed to have a space where they like a, they put in a living room, a shower. They went all out and restored that basement, like redid it and remodeled it, and I put in a bunch of original artwork there. And I had just a ton of fun working with them. This is the next house right next to it. The other one was called the Helmand House. I think these might have been made for their servants or I think a relative. There's three more. A friend of mine, Henry Tucker, owns this one. It's got leaded glass in just about every window. I've restored just about every window in the house. I've made them the back entry set I made from scratch. And it was real straightforward craftsman. He didn't want me to put my art in that one. He was a little nervous about letting me do any abstract or anything in the back door. After I did Nancy and Paul's, he hired me to do a second floor door panel with the abstractions, and now these three garage door. I just did those last year. They have modern Glenn Greens in them because Henry got hip after after I did the neighbors. He decided it was okay. This is the third house. I really don't know who lives there. I don't know much about this house. I know it has an interesting corner window that has stained glass kind of on the transom part there. It's like sort of like a buildings, some sort of European city on a hill. It's a nice looking house. The Scheibler, just you can't go wrong. I've worked on a ton of other Scheiblers, and I need to get out there with a camera and a video camera, and I need to go to all these Scheiblers. He's a prolific architect. The Beacon Gardens right up here, the first one next to Hillel is some local folks you might know, Dan and Ellen Legger. They're involved in the community pretty good. They let me do their front door with some pretty nice art.
He's the one who did the
need to get some pictures, like I say. This is kind of where they got the idea for mushrooms with Scheibler. This is the old Heidelberg right down the street from my shop, right on South Braddock Avenue. I've done a couple little repairs in there. They got a bunch of glass falling apart. They're not hurrying to fix it up. It's a big investment for a rental. Beautiful apartment. Troy decided he needed to live there. He's over there now. And this is some little ditty we did where they took take the old leaded glass, take the clear stuff out of the center, and make it real sunny in the middle. This is Troy's apartment. We let him have that one, and he hung it up on his balcony at the old Heidelberg. This is Scheibler's very first house. This is on South Braddock, just up from the Rankin Bridge in Swissvale. The corner window again you see there. Pretty neat for a first project. There's I donated a 12 by 12, one of my crate series. We're going to hear about the crate series in a minute. I donated a 12 by 12 crate series piece to the Waldorf School, and it ended up in the corner window. Whoever bought the donation, actually it's friends of mine. Some friends of mine actually live in the very first Scheibler, the Howisons. And they hung that 12 by 12 in that, and that makes me feel good. And here's the crate series. I brought one crate with me, which after the slideshow, we'll show you some. I brought live glass to show actual pieces. This is the crate series. I had one crate sitting around that would hold 8x8s, and I'm out of window space in my studio. So I decided, you know, like a record store, you know, you thumb through records. We ended up calling the crate series. My one buddy calls it the top 10. Each crate I built holds about 12 pieces. On the right, some people were bugging me to get them out of the crates and hang them up. So I took an old window frame with the dividers and put little cup holder hooks. And this is my 5x7 size. You're looking at the 12x12s. They are everyday discount. If you ever need a discount piece of fine art stained glass, they're my little soldiers marching out into the world. They're fighting a war on poverty and prejudice and conformity and corruption. You know, they're trying to march out and save the world. And there I am in my boy in his studio. The exit sign, this is my new studio, this is my light table where I cut all the glass. A local photographer gal that I'm friends with, Abby Kraftwitz, she
she took this nice picture of me with the exit sign, and there's some of the great 48 hung around. That one in the middle, a lot of people, that's the largest art piece I have in the shop. It's called A Week in the Life. That piece took me 7 days of cutting just to get the glass cut, not even putting it together. I had that frame, and I got the idea to go ahead, and it's not really pre-designed. A couple little sections I drew up as I went. It's very spontaneously created. At the time I did it back in 2001, I called it my piece de resistance songs. To cut that out in 7 days, I didn't sleep much. I didn't eat much. My CD changer with all the music, I didn't change the CDs for a week. I was completely focused. To get that done, it's basically working night and day, completely focused. One of the CDs that was on was the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper. So they have that A Day in the Life song. And that song kept coming up in very crucial times when I'm trying to create this. And I'm at a crucial juncture. And all of a sudden I realized that song's playing again. And then when I finished cutting it all out, I went, whew. I was like, oh man, that was 7 days in a row. No breaks. Oh, A Day in the Life, Week in the Life. That's how I got a title. I think that's about the end. We got anything else there? That's the end of the slideshow, folks. Want to hear some more? I brought pieces that black piece to look at.
Why don't we do that informally and come up if that's okay?
Okay, it's fine.
Some people are beyond their bedtime by now. Yep. This is just a marvelous talk. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other things, I was derelict earlier. Patty Hughes, most of you know her. She's our webmaster. When you send messages in to the Historical Society on the website, Patty makes sure they go where they're supposed to go. She's one of the founders, been with us for a long time, so I don't want to forget her. We have a tradition, a co-op tradition here, of people taking their chairs and putting them on the racks over there as you go out. We're not rushing you out of here. We've got the room. Come and see Glenn. Come and look at this nice artwork up here. But thank you, my friend.
Thank you.